butterflies for centuries have always been used to represent the life of a Christian. And many of us have seen butterflies used and have heard people talk about them, but sometimes we're not always clear on why in the world do we use butterflies many times to symbolize our discipleship in Christ. When the fact is, a butterfly is, you know, we know there's this beautiful, elegant, peaceful ambassador of the insect world. Where other insects are biting or attacking, they're repeating and sharing things, and their job is to help take pollen from different places. And it's just to give beauty to the world. But the butterfly, they don't start off that way. That beauty, that ability to glide and soar above the earth. Butterflies are produced through an amazing process, which we see them coming together and changing from a caterpillar, a worm-like creature that goes through a metamorphosis and becomes a butterfly. In fact, what happens is that a butterfly will lay her eggs, and from her eggs will emerge a caterpillar. And that's the first stage that's there. These insects will be laid, and strangely enough, the first thing they start doing is eating. And they eat so much at times that they can grow up to 100 times larger than they were when they were first born in the egg. But their growth, their transformation doesn't stop there, because that caterpillar wraps itself in a crystal, in a cocoon. And in that cocoon, we all know that amazing changes take place. And it's called this pupa stage, where the caterpillar becomes a gorgeous butterfly. And when it emerges, it's that delicate creature that we all see and admire every year. Through our history, butterflies have been used as a symbol of Christianity. In fact, the very verb that's used for metamorphosis, that change that butterflies go through, we see it used about four times in the New Testament. The first two times we see it, it's referring to Jesus. We see it referring in Matthew 17:2. We see it referring to Jesus in Mark 9:2. And it's at the point where Jesus is seen on the mountaintop. They're in the midst with Moses and Elijah, and the disciples were watching, and they said he took on this change, this glow when he was there. And we look at it and call it the Mount of Transfiguration, because there was a transforming that took place. But also, we see this same word transfiguration used in another way. We see it used referring to us, Christians, disciples of Christ. In fact, in Romans 12, 1 and 2, it says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercy of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to the world, but be, here's the word, transformed, the transfiguration, the metamorphosis. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God. You will discern what is the will of God, which is good and acceptable and perfect. But there's a fourth time, the second time for us, in 2 Corinthians 3:18. Again, we hear about this transforming power that happens to sinners to put us on a road to being saints. And in 2 Corinthians, Paul will, and we all will unveil, with unveiled face, behold, the glory of the Lord, are being transformed. We all are being transformed into the same image, from one degree of glory to the other. For just a hitting of a magic wand. He pops from that worm creature to something that can soar. But his whole body, as a living sacrifice to nature, goes through a change. And when he changes, he can change his elevation, change his attitude, change his ability, see things like he never could see them before. So that first stage where the caterpillar is hatching to the egg, and in that early life, that's us. Because in John 3, 1 through 8, it talks about being born again. And though that caterpillar is a living, you know, it's there on that egg, he is born anew from that egg. And when it gets to that second stage, where the caterpillar eats and eats and eats and eats, he does it because by the time it starts making its changes in the future, it can only make that change because of the food that it ate when the change was about to take place. And we, as believers, are to literally, as Jeremiah would say, eat the word. We are to feed on the word. We're supposed to take that word and have it become a part of us. And the reason we should read, the reason we should study and pray, the reason we should meditate so much is because the more it becomes a part of us, like that caterpillar, we're going to go through some changes. And life, when it puts you through those changes, because of that spiritual food that you've eaten, that I've eaten, God can use that spiritual food to transform us into something that we were never even able to conceive beforehand. When we see the world on one level, and we'll be able to see the world in a different level. And in that cocoon stage when that butterfly goes out and lays other eggs, that's our job, not to just change and become more like Christ, but to go out and plant seeds, to go out and lay thoughts of life in the minds of others so they can take root and they too can go through their change and they can become disciples of Christ. It is my hope that you and I will continue to feed on the Word of God. It's my hope that we would allow the Word to change us into the image of Christ more and more each day. And we have to share that gospel in order to make new disciples. This cannot happen until we seek and accept and become faithful to the word, to the will, and to the way of Christ. Our text starts off in verse 7, looking at the Amplified Version, and it says, so submit to the authority of God. Submit to the authority of God. Resist the devil. Stand firm against him, and he will flee from you. So if we want to truly have a new normal in our lives, it starts off with us submitting, you know, to submit yourself to the Savior. Now understand, this is the third sermon in this series. We've talked about giving ourselves to Christ. We've talked about going through a change. We've talked about surrendering ourselves to the Savior to help get rid of our sins. But many of us still don't feel that we can fly. Many of us still don't feel that we can be stuck in a place where we no longer want to be, and we don't know how to lift up beyond it and soar to a new thought, a new place, a new ability, a new lifestyle. Submit yourself to the Savior. The word itself, submit. It means that you are something, or you are choosing to use something or someone to be over you, to be, you know, where you are subordinate to them. You obey them. That's what happens when you submit. I submit myself, I will obey. And as disciples of Christ, we are to submit ourselves to the Lord. Now, submitting to God means doing things God's way when you'd rather do them your way. Submitting to God, it means staying put somewhere when you know you really want to leave and run away. Submitting to God, it means to stay silent when sometimes we want our mouth to just go off and put when you know in your flesh you want to let go and strike out. Now, let's pause for a moment for a reality check, because the truth is we often resent being told to submit. If we said someone had nerve enough to get in my face telling me what I better do, we don't like it when we feel that someone is saying, you must submit. That's just the reality of our human nature. Children will yell and scream and have a tantrum. Some of them will just sit there and say, I'm not even going to go to the bathroom because I'm going to control myself. That's all I can do. And as the age gets older, we want to stay in control. And many times when we think we've reached our worst place in life, it's when we say things like, I lost control. I couldn't do. I couldn't handle. But we still find it hard to submit sometimes to Christ. And yet, Jesus chose to submit himself to his Heavenly Father. You see, Jesus said to his disciples, he says to us, everything I have told you comes from the Father. Surely, with all the dissension, with all the betrayal, with all the denying that took place around Jesus, around the crucifixion, surely he had some words he could have shared with us. But even in his point of pain and grief, everything that he said to us came from his Heavenly Father. That's submission. And when Jesus was about to leave this earth, he said to his disciples, I will not leave you lonely. I will leave to you the paraclete, the comforter, the Spirit, to be there with you while I go back to my Heavenly Father. And that Spirit of the Lord stays in harmony with the words of Christ in order to fulfill the will of their Heavenly Father. In other words, submission is not something we do just to say Christ is our master. Submission is something we do when we finally understand Christ is our mentor. Not just master, but our mentor. Because like the Father to the Son and the Son to the Spirit, once that understanding of spiritual submission takes place, they are no longer different. The one may be in heaven. The one may be on the cross, though one may live within us. We call them the Trinity, three in one. And when we submit to the Word, we become one. That's why in John 15, Jesus, we hear the words of Jesus when he said these words. That his word must be in us. Jesus says, if you really want to be my disciple, you must be in me and my word must be in you. In John 17, we hear Jesus praying. We hear him say to his Heavenly Father, I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. Future, unknown, unborn Christians. I'm praying for them. I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, and I am in you. Jesus said, may they be in us, so that the world will believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me, so they may be one as we are one. Submission is finding God's peace and love between us. So some people will read, you know, in Ephesians, and they get happy and then they get upset. You know, a mother might get happy when she reads the words of about her children as opposed to honor their mother and father. And then that one thing a woman may get upset when it says that the wife should be submissive to the husband. When I was a national pastor, out there was this one who was smart as whip. While everybody else was learning their ABCs, he was reading. And I remember his father wanting to put him in his place. All right, come on up here. What's this word say? What is it say? Read it. You think you want to do things? What does that say? He said, Daddy, it said, honor your mother and father. That's what I'm talking about. He said, but Daddy, down here, he said, parents, do not provoke your children to wrath. There is supposed to be a unity between us. That's why it's not enough to just submit yourself to the Savior. You must not only submit yourself to the Savior, but admit your sins to the Savior. Even when that husband and wife may get into it, and it says, we fight submission because we don't read all of it. Somebody said, how can you say a wife should submit to her husband? I can't crush you say, well, are you telling me you're a chauvinist? I said, no, I ain't got guts enough to do that to him. Well, how can you say talk about submission? That's because it says that the wives should submit to the husband. They looked at me and went, so now what do you think that means? And I said, turn page. Read the rest of the text. And it says, wives, submit to your husbands, and husbands, like Christ, be there and be willing to give your very life for her. That's a pretty good deal, don't you think? It means when that battlefront comes and bullets from misunderstanding comes, his body, his person, his gift is to be in front of you. He is to love you. He is to provide for you. He is to protect you. Are you still complaining? But then there's a catch verse. It says, husband and wives, submit to one another because of your reverence to Christ. In other words, I'm not saying he knows best. I'm not saying she knows best. I'm saying you all will know best when you all submit to the will, to the word, and to the ways of the Father. But nothing can change. Even if God gives us all we need like a butterfly, we can't soar above our fears and our addictions and our worries and our failures if we don't not only submit ourselves to the Savior, but admit our sins to the Savior. That's why the text says, resist the devil. Stand firm against him, and he will flee from you. It is by getting close to God that we resist the devil. What our text is trying to remind us is that we are always in a spiritual warfare. And when there's a spiritual war going on, you can't be on both sides of the war. You're either on the side of the divine or we're on the side of the devil. But we can't be on the side of both. Even Jesus says, you can only serve one master. You will either love one and hate the other, or love this one and hate that one. And if we don't make a conscious choice to commit ourselves to Christ, our non-compliance will stop us and block us from accepting and surrendering our sins to the Savior. I remember there was a man and a woman I was reading about that just moved into a town, and the wife called her husband up on a cell phone. He was coming for the first time from his new job and getting back home. He thought he was lost, but he was trying to figure out where he was going. And his wife called up and said, "Hon, be careful. The news media is on the radio, and they're saying there's a crazy man out there. He's on Highway 280, and he's going in the wrong direction. So, baby, please be careful." He came back and said, "I believe every word, but it's not just one. I see hundreds of cars going in the wrong direction." Sometimes we can be so wrong that we think everybody else is wrong, and we're the only ones that know. And we can't admit that sin and be saved until we learn to submit. That's why we must give ourselves over to the authority of God. That's why in verse 8 it says, come close to God with a contrite heart, and he will come close to you. Wash your hands, you said, and purify your unfaithful hearts, you double-minded people. And in verse 10 it says, to close, humble yourselves with an attitude of repentance and insignificance in the presence of the Lord, and he will exalt you. He will lift you up. He will give you purpose. That caterpillar doesn't see his or her purpose until they're soaring. As long as they're crawling, that dirt, that garden below is their world. And it's not until they, one, submit themselves to the Savior, two, admit their sins to the Savior, and three, commit yourselves to the Savior, that a butterfly learns to fly. And that's the things that we must do. Now, it's difficult sometimes when we don't clearly see what's happening. Because sometimes our pride gets in the way. I mean, I know you've seen it, you know, where you have a prideful person, an arrogant person. A prideful person are always telling you about themselves and their accomplishments and how smart and wonderful they are. But those who are submit themselves to the Savior, they look at you to continue to their conversation, trying to magnify what God can do, what God can do through us, and how we are nothing without him. Queen Victoria. History writes that Queen Victoria had a wonderful marriage with her husband, Prince Albert. Albert again. And one day it said that the queen was hitting her mantle and disagreeing with something that her husband said. And he looked at her and just turned and walked away and went to his own bedroom chambers and closed the door. The queen, in anger, left her throne and went to where he was. And she started beating on the door. Open up this door! And he said, who's there? And she said, what do you mean, who's there? The queen! The queen is here. And the door never opened. And then all of a sudden, historians write that there was a small, gentle knock on the door. Can I come in? Who's there? It's your wife. And the door open. Beloved, sometimes we go to Christ believing what the world may say about us. Sometimes we go to Christ holding up a feeling of authority because of things we may control on earth. But we have brought Christ. And no matter how important we think we are, we can't bang on that door saying, Jesus, this is what you better do. I remember one time when I was about 21, I was conducting a choir. We had about 75 people in the young adult choir. And it was a wonderful thing. We were in rehearsal, and we started off with prayer. We were holding prayer, and this young lady was visiting. And she said, do you mind if I pray this morning? I said, well, please, this afternoon, we have guests. Why don't you pray? So she started praying for us. And she went into, now, Lord, you need to listen up, because you've given us the authority, so I am demanding what you better do. Lord, I am telling you, Lord Jesus. And all of a sudden, I did one of these numbers. And I'm moved to the side, and somebody opened up their eyes and said, "What are you doing?" I said, "Just in case of lightning." We can say, "Lord, Lord," and he may say, "I never knew you." True submission comes when we knock. Or even when he knocks. Revelation says that Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock. And anyone that opens, I will come in. And I will sup with them, and they will sup with me. But when Jesus has turned away from us, who's there? It's your pride, Jesus. Who's there? Lord, I'm here. We need to be one. All of us find ourselves, as we get ready to leave here this morning, all of us find ourselves having a problem with finding unity. I understand that you are not the person you used to be. Thank God I'm not the person I used to be. And I pray I'm not the person that I'm going to be. Because 30-year-old eyes can't see what 40-year-old eyes know. And 40-year-old eyes miss 70. And 70 doesn't know what's going to happen with 80 eyes. But it's not until we see ourselves through the eyes of Jesus. We must humble ourselves to him. And we do it by taking down our pride and our arrogance and give ourselves over to him. Lord, I belong to you. I close. You remember me telling you about the butterfly? You remember me telling you how the eggs are laid, and once they come out, there are these little bitty worm-like things called caterpillars, and how once they were born, they still can't do anything, but they would start eating, and they would eat so much they could grow 100 times bigger than what they used to be. And then they wrap themselves in a cocoon. And when they break out, they fly. Fly above the pain, the sorrows, the ground, the lack of vision that was there before. But here's the rest of the story. I remember watching the butterfly. In school, they would put them in the eggs in, and the caterpillars would come, and they would put themselves in a cocoon, and then they would come out. And I watched this butterfly as the tent was opened up so the butterfly could take flight. And the butterfly got ready to soar and could move. The butterfly began to flap, and nothing happened. And then it's as if I noticed it and the butterfly noticed it at the same time. The leg of the butterfly was caught on the end of the cocoon. And all of a sudden, the butterfly quit paying attention to flight and just dealt with getting detached from the cocoon. Beloved, a cocoon is where your suffering took place. A cocoon is where Christ met you, where you needed him to take you where you couldn't be. A cocoon is the memory of what you used to be. That butterfly realized, I can fly, but the cocoon has got to go. Many of us already have what we need to fly above our past, our pain, and our shame. But Paul closes with this thought in Ephesians 4:17. But that isn't what you learned about Christ. Since you have heard about Jesus and have learned the truth that comes from him, throw off your old sinful nature and your former ways of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the